have to go noteless and just figure that I can go around. There it is. Okay, all good. All right. Everything's fine. All right, we've got the King of Aram. We've got Israel. We've got the King of Aram's plans are being foiled because Elisha the prophet keeps telling the King of Israel where Aram's, the Arameans are hiding out to go get them and everything else. So the King of Aram thinks it's one of his close insiders who's betraying them. And they insist, no, it's not us, it's this man of God. This man of God can tell the King of Israel even the secrets that you whisper in your bedroom. So naturally, the king says, go and get him. His response isn't, wow, really? This man can do this? That's kind of incredible. He must be a servant of the one true God, and maybe I should give my allegiance to that God. No, instead, his response is, I need to go get him and kill this guy. He's messing with my plans, what I want to do. So anyway, the King of Aram's men tell him that Elisha is in Dothan. See, I wouldn't have known that it's Dothan. So Elisha is hanging out in Dothan. So the King of Aram sends a party to go and get him. And they went by night with horses and chariots and with all kinds of armies, and they surround this city. And early the next morning, Elisha's servant went out, and he looks around him and he sees all these forces, these horses, these chariots that are surrounding the city. And terrified, he runs to Elisha and he says, look at this, we're doomed. What are we going to do? But Elisha calmly says to him, do not be afraid. The phrase that messengers from God say more than anything else to human beings when they encounter them, do not be afraid. And then he says, there are more who are with us than are with them. And then he prays, Lord, open his eyes. Open the eyes of my servant so that he can see. And God opens the servant's eyes and he sees on the hills all around horses and chariots of fire, full scale all around, surrounding the armies that are surrounding them. And this was the image that was in my head all week. The close of the story is basically Elisha kind of does another prophet Jedi mind trick on them, and he says, the man you are looking for is not here. Let me take you to him, and he leads all these people away somewhere else. So you know that whole, these are not the droids you're looking for? It first happened with Elisha. They were, might have been dressed up like stormtroopers, I don't know. Okay, so this is the image, but the image of not seeing and then having your eyes open and seeing the bigger picture was what was in my head this weekend. Lord, open my eyes so that I can see. There's no doubt that things aren't going the way that I plan. There's no doubt that everything that happens is beyond my control. It's beyond our control. So I give up. Let me see what it is that you're doing, what you have in store. Every Sunday, before the service, those who are playing on the worship team, and basically anyone involved in the service, and you're all invited, by the way, at about 10:25, we gather over there and we pray together before the service. And one of the things, hope I don't embarrass you, Jay. Now you're waiting for it. So one of the things that Jay prays that I really like is he prays, it's a good catchphrase for an open heaven. And I love that. That idea of praying for an open heaven. Yes, today, every day, we want an open heaven. And we pray for an open heaven. And when we do, I feel like we're less praying that God would do something new than we are praying that God would open our eyes to the way things really are from his perspective in the first place. And this is, in essence, what the gospel is about. This is, in essence, what Jesus' coming is about. While sin created a barrier between human beings and God, between heaven and earth, Jesus comes to break that barrier, to kick holes in the ceiling that separates our reality from God's. I love there's a Canadian, Bruce Coburn, line that he's going to kick the darkness until it bleeds daylight. That's what Christ comes to do. He comes to break that ceiling that separates heaven and earth. He comes to tear the curtain of the temple that separates the holy place of God's dwelling from the profane world outside. And if that weren't enough, he comes to tear the temple down and make us, even us, the temple of his presence. Amen. So that in him, and then in us, because of him, that vision of Ezekiel is fulfilled. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is filled with his glory. The whole earth will exalt his name. That's what we sang in that Agnes Day. Right. And it's John in Revelation, in his vision, he's seeing the final consummation of all things. This is the declaration of God's final victory, that now at long last, that the dwelling place of God has been established, and it's with people, not separate. That's the grand victory, that now God dwells with his people. The point of the story is God's presence. Way at the beginning of the story, there's this awesome, powerful scene when Israel had sinned right after being delivered from bondage in Egypt. And God gets really, really angry, and he says that he's going to destroy them, and he says, okay, I'm not going to destroy them. But instead he says, Moses, go ahead and lead this people, but I'm too angry to go with them. And in my anger, I might just up and destroy them, plain out. But Moses pleads with the Lord on behalf of the people, and he says, don't send us out unless your presence goes with us. How will anyone know that we belong to you unless your presence goes with us? God's presence is everything. The virgin will give birth to a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. And when the angels at that birth sung in the field, it wasn't just so that we have something cool to imitate in for 2,000 years worth of Christmas pageants. It was to show that God's reality and our reality were being joined in this person of Christ. And the message that God loves you and me is nothing other than that message right now. Whatever crap, stuff, other words, you're dealing with right now. Whatever stuff is going on, whatever prison that you're in, God is right now speaking your name and proclaiming freedom for you, forgiveness for you, love for you, and that invitation to open our eyes and to know that we're already home free in the grasp of Christ's love. He stands in our place today and forever, and he offers you his place of joy and peace and freedom and relationship with the Father. And whatever we're facing, however bleak or hopeless, even death itself has been made the pathway to victory in Christ. That's what death and resurrection is all about. So I'm going to close with reading the broader context of that passage that Paul writes to the Corinthians. Therefore, and this is 2 Corinthians. Since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the mind of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of the Father. For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. But we have all this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. Amen. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Right. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may also be revealed in our mortal body. So then, death is at work in us, but life is at work within you. It's written, "I believe, therefore I have spoken." Since we have that same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak. We because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you to himself. All this is for your benefit, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. Therefore, we don't lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal.
Amen.
Amen.
God, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. We thank you that our troubles and our sorrows and our trials, though they seem heavy, are light and momentary in the light of your eternity and your love. Grasp us in that love, Lord. Open our eyes to see your power and presence around us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.